How serious a situation is the inflation factor that gets introduced this week, and is the numbers we saw in the monthly increase are beyond any of the expectations for this year. How much of a problem is that with inflation going up 50% in terms of the point factor in a month?
Yeah, look, it's worrisome in the sense that it hits ordinary people in their pocketbooks, and that is a concern, and obviously we will continue to monitor. It's one of the reasons we reduced the GST, and we want to keep taxes down for people because we know there are those cost of living pressures. Inflation itself, in terms of the government, actually doesn't affect our fiscal track very much. So that's not a problem. But what we need to worry about, what could affect our fiscal track, is obviously the growth scenarios here in Canada and around the world. It's predicted, projected to be healthy going forward, but obviously we're going to have to continue to work with our partners in the G20 to keep the economic recovery on track.
When you say it doesn't affect your fiscal track, yeah. If it starts having an impact on interest rates, which a lot of people think it could, that would
well, it not? It would have some, but as I say, our debt level is so much lower than it used to be.
It's a number that government would rather you not focus on. It's the rapidly escalating national debt. And it's not just a bunch of red ink numbers spinning faster than a slot machine. Debt opponents claiming it's a gamble with our economic future.
Spending isn't curtailed, and if interest rates rise, the problem may again spiral out of control as it once did. As Canada faces a steep demographic crisis, the situation will become more difficult, not less.
Our debt numbers were shocking back in the 1990s when the first debt clock was unveiled. Back then, people were stunned by the amount of government spending.
When you say it doesn't affect your fiscal track, if it starts having an impact on interest rates, which a lot of people think it could, that would
well,
it not?
It would have some, but as I say, our debt level is so much lower than it used to be that today the possibility of a kind of a debt payment deficit spiral is not there as long as we continue to eliminate the deficit. Look, the deficit has come down by one quarter.
The Honourable Member for Mississauga, Arendelle.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My question to the minister is, can he tell us who is the highest spending finance minister in Canada's history?
The Honourable Minister of Finance.
I believe our budget. Yes, I can.
The Honourable Member for Mississauga.
Oh, that's good. Mr. Chair, will he admit that he is the highest spending finance in Canada's history?
Yes.
The Honourable Minister of Finance.
Is he allowed to call me he? No? Yes?
I feel like I just dropped into an episode of Matlock.
Yes.
The Honourable Member.
Back in 1997, the federal debt hit a record $563 billion. By 2008, it was wrestled down to $458 billion, but now it's $559 billion and growing.
You cannot borrow your way to financial independence, whether you're an individual, a corporation, or a country. So at some point, there's got to be that line in the sand that says, we're not going to spend anymore, we're going to have to cut.
It looks like a large out-of-control gas pump, but the bottom line is each person's debt share is $16,500, and that doesn't even include provincial debt. Getting young people to have to pay it, concerned, might be tough.
I feel like I just dropped into an episode of Matlock.
Yes.
The Honourable Member.
Ahead of next week's federal budget. The debt clock stopped in London on Tuesday.
It's a visual representation of our country's federal debt. That's the portion of money that our federal government has borrowed over the years that we now owe, and it is clicking upwards in real time.
Canada's federal government is borrowing at a rate of $1,400 a second.
James Flaherty, our finance minister, has put out this particular booklet. This is last year's financial budget, and our 2007 one has just been approved, but this was sent out to all the members of parliament across the country, and it's called Canada's New Government, Turning a New Leaf. Now, inside this particular booklet is a statement of how much we pay in interest and how much our national debt is. Now, I have taken the numbers that are here. The interest that we had to pay in 2004-2005 was $34.1 billion on a national debt of $494.4 billion. The next year we paid roughly the same, $33.7 billion. That's 2005-2006. 2006-2007, $34.8 billion. And the projected amount we'll pay in 2007-2008, a total of $137.4 billion will be paid over that four-year period to bankers who, from whom we've borrowed the money to buy the goods and services that we need for the country. Now, when you go back in history, you cannot help but find that statements time and time again, money exists not by nature but by law. And if money exists by law, why is it produced by the private banks then? What right do they have? Would you give it to the private banks, or would you give it to the police force? Would you give it to the mafia? Who would you allow to print the money that the nation needs if it is created by law? The only people who have the legal right to create money is the federal government or the government of the people, because they are accountable to the people. And we're only paying out this huge sum of interest because our governments fail to abide by the law and print the money which only they have the exclusive right to. And in Canada, in the Canadian Constitution of 1867, Article 91 states very clearly that only the government has the exclusive right to create the nation's money. And this same clause is in the American Constitution. Yet, governments will go to private banks and allow them to create the money. In 1934, in Canada, we were in the midst of a depression. We created a bank called the Bank of Canada, and it was given the right to create the money for Canada. And the money that was being created by the private banks was phased out then over the next 10 years. So what we really had was what was called legal tender. But gradually, because of the way the promise to pay money, check money, the banks got control of all of our money creation again through check money and promise to pay money, M2 money. We have the Bank of Canada Act of 1934, and it did spell out clearly that the government should create the money and the Bank of Canada should lend the money, not lend it, but spend it into existence for social and public projects. The United States, since the Federal Reserve Act of 1913, the creation of money in the United States has been totally in the hands of a private consortium known as the Federal Reserve Group. But we in Canada have the laws on our books, and the Bank of Canada Act has not been changed. The preamble reads the same. The clauses in the Bank of Canada Act are still there. The only thing that is lacking in Canada is that our politicians do not abide by the act and do not force our government to print the nation's money. In Canada, all the shares for the Bank of Canada are held on behalf of the people by our finance minister, our federal finance minister. And he has final say by law on the creation of money for Canada.
That's good. Mr. Chair, will he admit that he is the highest spending finance in Canada's history?
Yes.
The Honourable Minister of Finance.
I feel like I just dropped into an episode of Matlock.
Yes.
The study of money, above all other fields in economics, is one in which complexity is used to disguise truth, not reveal it. Now, here's a quote that we really must grasp, and this is where our downfall is because most people don't grasp it, because it is deliberately confused. Of all the contrivances for cheating the laboring classes of mankind, none has been more effective than that which deludes them with paper money. When people understand what is being perpetrated on them, they will speak out, just as a number of good congressmen in the United States have. I have here a quote from Congressman Wright Patman. "I have never yet had anyone who could, through the use of logic and reason, justify the federal government borrowing the use of its own money." There's another statement by him that I have here, which says, "There is not a single person within range of my voice who does not know that the Federal Reserve is an illegal organization that puts people into debt unnecessarily." Wright Patman in Canada, the best question for that is, answer for that is Gerald Grattan McGeer. And we could do a documentary on Gerald Grattan McGeer. He was should have been listed as Canada's greatest Canadian. In 1935, he single-handedly, he was a brilliant lawyer, King's Counsel, an MP at that time, and also a legislator in the BC government for a number of years. But he single-handedly caught the Macmillan Commission, which was sent out from Britain, the Lord Macmillan Commission, to fix our economy. He cowed them and talked to them as if they were a bunch of freshmen in college. And as a result of Gerald Grattan McGeer, the Bank of Canada became a reality, and his recommendations are the base of the Bank of Canada Act, and they still are law.
On the subject of economic management, this has been not reported much in the media, to my surprise, but what do you feel about Bank of Canada Governor Mark Carney's decision to hire Tim Hodgson, the CEO of Goldman Sachs Canada, to come on as a special advisor to him starting in September?
I think Tim Hodgson is a great guy, and Mark Carney is even better. We need all the expertise we can get to guide the economy. We're in very, very uncertain waters. I mean, I was in a factory in Quebec just yesterday, and I was talking to the guy, and they make wind turbines and turbines for every kind of operation in the U.S. market, and he said, you know, we just don't have any orders after 2011 or into 2011. So there's an enormous amount of uncertainty in the economy, and we need the best and brightest minds out there to guide us through there, because there's a risk. I don't want to talk the economy down, but there's a risk that we're heading for another slowdown, and I don't want that to happen. So we need good leadership from the Bank of Canada. And if Mark Carney thinks he needs some more advice, then he should get any advice he needs.
Would ordinary Canadians have cause to be concerned, though, that Goldman Sachs, or that the CEO of Goldman Sachs Canada, a company that was involved, for instance, in the 2008 subprime mortgage crisis in the U.S. that's been involved in Mexico back in 94, Russia in 98, would be a little bit, have reason to be a little concerned that this company is now advising the Bank of Canada on how to govern the Canadian economy?
I happen to know that Tim Hodgson's a smart guy who's in it for good reasons. He's not, just focus on the guy. He's a bright and able man who wants to help the country, and I think he'll give Mr. Carney good advice. And I know that I just feel pretty strongly that Mark Carney knows what he's doing, and we're lucky to have a central bank governor of this quality. I think we would have had a much rougher time economically had he not been at the wheel. I can criticize the Conservative government for their economic management, but I'd be hard-pressed to criticize the governor of the Bank of Canada. I think he's done a great job.
Michael Levy.
Yes, sir.
You said that knowledge is power. Let me give some to the people in the form of a quote from Thomas Jefferson. If the American people ever allow private banks to control the issuance of their currency, first by inflation and then by deflation, the banks and corporations that will grow up around them will deprive the people of all their property until their children wake up homeless on the continent their fathers conquered. The issuing power should be removed from the banks and restored to the people to whom it properly belongs. I sincerely believe that banking institutions are more dangerous to our liberties than standing armies. I'm not telling you anything that you don't know, of course, just things that you cannot admit. Everybody says follow the money. Nobody follows it backwards to the printers.
The fact remains is that the U.S. Federal Reserve is a consortium of private banks. The chairman of the U.S. Federal Reserve is appointed by the president, but the U.S. Fed is private.
That's why they say, permit me to issue a country's currency and I don't care who makes its laws. If you're the guy with the printer, you're the decider.